Blackstone Audio presents Hungry Tales by Jonathan Maberry. This book is read by Tom Weiner. Calling Death by Jonathan Maberry.
It weren't the wind,
said Granny Adkins. The young man perched on the edge of the other rocker, head tilted to lift one ear like a startled bird, listening to the sound. He was stick-thin and beaky-nosed, and Granny thought he looked like a heron, the way they looked when they were ready to take sudden flight.
Are you sure?
Sure as maybe,
said Granny, nodding out to the darkness.
The wind fair howls when it comes across the top of Baldur Rise. Howls like the devil himself.
Sounds like a howl to me, said the young man. What else could you call it? Granny sucked in a lungful of smoke from her pall mall, held it inside for a five count, and then stuck out her lower lip to exhale in a vertical line up past her face. She didn't like to blow smoke on guests, and there was a breeze blowing toward the house. A chime made from old bent forks and chicken bones stirred and tinkled. She squinted with her one good eye, the blue one, not the one that had gone milky white when a wasp stung her there 40 years back, and considered how she wanted to answer the young man. Before she spoke, the sound came again, low, distant, plaintive. She left her initial response unspoken for a moment as they sat in the dark and listened.
There, she said softly. You hear it?
Yes, but it still sounds like a...
No, son, that ain't what I meant. Can you hear the sound? The moan?
Yes,
he said, leaning into the wind, tilting one ear directly into its path.
Now,
said Granny.
Can you hear the wind, too?
He began, but let his voice trail off. Granny waited, watching his face by starlight, looking for the moment when he did hear it. His head lifted like a bird dog's.
Yes, I hear it.
They listened to the moan. It was there, but the wind was dying off again, and the sound was fainter, thinner.
That moan, the young man said tentatively. It's not the wind. You're right.
She nodded, satisfied.
It's a separate sound, continued the young man. I think it's being carried on the wind.
He looked to her for approval. She gave him another nod.
That's another thing about living up here in the hills,
she said, tying this to their previous conversation.
When you live simple and close to the land, you don't get as blunt as folks in the cities do. You hear things, see things the way they are, not the way you suppose them to be. You notice that there are more things around you, and that they're there all the time.
The young man nodded, but he was half distracted by the moans, so Granny let him listen for a spell. His name was Joshua Tharp, a good name, biblical first name, solid last name, a practical name, which Granny always appreciated because she thought that a name said a lot about a person. She would never have come out onto the porch if he'd had a foreign-sounding name or a two-first-name name, like Simon Thomas. Everyone Granny knew with two Christian names was a scoundrel and half in the devil's bag already. However, this boy had a good name. There had been Tharps in this country going back more generations than Granny could count, and she knew family lines 4 decades past the War of Northern Aggression. Her own people had been here since before America was America. So Joshua Tharp was a decent name, and well worth a little bit of civility. He was a college boy from Pittsburgh who was willing to pay attention and treat older folks with respect. Wasn't pushy, neither, and that went a long way down the road with Granny. When he'd shown up on her doorstep, he took off his hat and said,
"Ma'am,"
and told her that he was writing a book about the coal miners in Pennsylvania and North Carolina, and was using his own family as the thread that sewed the two states together. Now they were deep into their third porch sitting, and the conversation wandered a crooked mile through late afternoon and on into the full dark of night. Talking about Granny and her kin, and about the Tharps here and the Tharps that had gone on. Joshua was a whiskey-holler Tharp, though, but there was no one left around here closer than a third cousin with a couple of removes, so everyone told him to go see Granny Adkins.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.